Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Zulekha Malik, and if you want to know more about me, you can visit my profile on sqadia.com. Now, let us proceed to the topic that we are going to study today. Today we are going to study about the cell, which is the basic unit of life, its membrane, and the transport of substances through the cell membrane. Now, what are we going to discuss in our lecture? Let us see. First, we are going to introduce the cell, and then we are going to proceed towards cell membrane, and then the functions that are performed by the cell membrane, and then the different types of transport that occur across the cell membrane. Now, let us revise our knowledge about cell. It is the basic and the smallest unit of life. We already know that everything is made up of cells, and everything that happens inside our body, it is controlled by cells. Now, it forms the structural, functional, and biological basis of organisms. As you can see in this diagram, this is the outline of the cell, which is known as the cell membrane. This is going to be our main topic for today. And these are the different kind of organelles that are present inside the cell. Now, what does this cell membrane do? It keeps the contents of the cell inside, and it protects the cell contents from the outside environment. The other organelles have their own functions, like mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell, nucleus is the brain of the cell. But today we are going to concentrate more on the cell membrane. So the components can be broadly classified as the nucleus, which is covered by a nuclear membrane, and the cytoplasm that is covered by the cell membrane. Now, you know, it's like this room has a door, and everything that is inside this room cannot go outside that easily. It has to go through that door. This is a function performed by the cell membrane. It is a fluid mosaic model. Now we are going to discuss what is meant by a fluid mosaic model. Fluid means it is a flexible layer. It's not rigid and rubbery like it or stiff, you know. But it is flexible and fluid. There is fluidity inside the membrane. The mosaic is like a painting which has different kinds of colors and materials present inside. So this is exactly what happens in a cell membrane. As you can see in this 3D diagram, there are proteins. You can see a lipid bilayer. There is cholesterol. There is going to be many molecules. It's like a multifunctional unit. And that is why it is known as a fluid mosaic model. It's a flexible layer of lipid molecules interspersed with large protein molecules, and they act as channels through which other molecules can enter and leave the cell. Now we will review the functions. The first and the foremost important function would be protection. It's like the cell membrane is a door, and it will not allow the harmful substances to enter the cell, and it will allow the important structure, the molecules that are needed by the cell, like glucose, like oxygen, and carbon dioxide needs to go out. So what is the structure that controls all these movements? It is the cell membrane. So it will provide protection, and it will provide cell-to-cell recognition, and it controls transport of metabolites. It prevents entry of harmful substances, and it promotes entry of useful substances. We also need to excrete the substances that are toxic, which are the debris, the waste debris. It needs to be expelled out of the cell. Now, that is also the function of cell membrane. So we have covered the cell and its organelles, the cell membrane, and the functions performed by the cell membrane. Now let's move on to the main topic, which is the highlight of this lecture, the types of membrane transport, how it occurs, and how it is regulated by the membrane structures. Now the cell membrane, as we studied the fluid mosaic model, is a lipid bilayer. Bilayer means it is there are two layers. And phospholipid means phospho, as you can see from the name, it's a phosphate molecule, and lipid is would form the middle area of the cell membrane. So the heads are hydrophilic, which means water soluble. They love water and they will allow water. And hydrophobic tails, hydrophobic means they are not very easily water soluble. They're lipid soluble. So these are two contrasting things. So the bilayer constitutes barrier for most water soluble substances. However, lipid soluble substances can usually pass easily. So the water is polar and it is a very small molecule. So it is the most abundant material that comes and goes out of the cell. It maintains the tonicity and maintains the cell volume. So that is why water can easily pass. So the one part would be the phospholipid bilayer and the other would be the membrane proteins. These proteins are also embedded in the lipid bilayer. They are integral part of the cell membrane. Now, what do these proteins do? They provide channels. They could be carriers. They facilitate the movement in and out. So that is the function of the proteins. And the phospholipid bilayer is also due to water solubility or lipid solubility would also check. It's like a check post. So this is a diagram that would show you precisely what we mean by hydrophobic and hydrophilic ends. Now you can see the heads and you can see the tails. These are this area in the middle is the hydrophobic part and these heads are hydrophilic. These are phospholipids. Collectively they would be known as phospholipids and these are proteins. So if the protein passes through the whole membrane from start to bottom, as you can see like this one, it's a transmembrane protein. It's an integral protein. And the cholesterol, it is going to be present in between the layers. Cholesterol is the main ingredient that provides the fluidity of the cell membrane. That is why it's called as fluid mosaic model. And these are the peripheral proteins. Proteins could be globular proteins. There are various types of proteins. That is why it's a mosaic. So the protein molecules in the bilayer, they constitute an alternate transport pathway. Apart from the phospholipid bilayer, now we are talking about the membrane proteins. They could either be channel proteins or they could be carrier proteins. The channel proteins would be just like tunnels that allow substances to pass through them. It's not that difficult. It's quite relatively easy from the carrier proteins. Now, carrier proteins are a bit complicated. They are they undergo some conformational change that would allow the passage of the molecule to the inside of the cell or outside as well. So basically, carrier proteins undergo changes in their structure that would enhance or reduce the flow of the substances. What do you mean by the term known as membrane transport? When we talk about membrane transport, we are talking about the collection of mechanisms that regulate the passage of solutes such as ions and small molecules through biological membranes. This would be the definition of membrane transport. So now we are going to discuss in detail the transport mechanisms that occur across the cell membrane. If you broadly classify the types of transport, you could say that it's either active or it's either passive. As you can tell from the name, the passive transport is something that does not require energy. And active transport is something that requires energy to work, to function properly. Further, the passive transport could be divided into two types, simple diffusion or facilitated diffusion. So whenever the term comes, a term known as diffusion comes, it should be in your mind that it is, we are talking about passive transport now. And then comes the active transport. These are two types of transport, but they differ in their mechanism of action. So you can see from this diagram, as you can see, this is a phospholipid bilayer. This is the hydrophobic part. This is the hydrophilic part. And when you are talking about diffusion, simple diffusion, you can see these ions or these solutes or these molecules, they want to come from this side to this side. And the difference between these two sides is that this is a high concentration area. There's a lot of molecules on this side and only a few, very little on this side. So the molecule is traveling from a high concentration area to a low concentration area through this lipid bilayer. And it is occurring very naturally. It's not so complicated. It just occurs. The molecules could be number of things. The molecules are small. They're not polar, so they can pass easily. And also when you're going It's like, you know, when you are going uphill, it's very difficult. But you're going down the hill or down the stairs, it's not so hard. You can come down easily. But if you're going up the hill or up the stairs, you would require energy. So this is the main difference between these two types of transport. This will not require any energy. This is passive transport. And then there is facilitated diffusion. Now, facilitated diffusion will have carrier proteins, which is absent from this simple diffusion. The carrier proteins will change their structure and allow the passage of these molecules from one side to the other. They are changing their structure. Here there are also water channels or watery channels are present in simple diffusion as well. But they are not so complicated. Here there are specific carrier proteins. But the same condition is applied here, that the molecule is traveling from a high concentration area to a low concentration area. So these would be, briefly, we just described the types of passive transport. Now, in this diagram, there's just a brief outline of active transport as well. You can see there is also a type of protein present. Any type of transport protein, it could be carrier protein, okay? So, but the molecule is traveling from a low concentration area to a high concentration area. This would require energy because it's not easy. And this energy is going to come from the main unit, the currency of energy in the body, which is ATP. So this is briefly the active transport. Now this is a table that describes the main differences between the two types of transport in a very summarized form. You can see there is no energy needed, no ATP required in passive transport. Whereas in active transport, you require the use of energy in the form of ATP. This occurs down a concentration gradient from a high to low concentration. And this is against a concentration gradient from low to high. Now, the facilitated diffusion requires the use of proteins, carrier. They could be carrier proteins. They could be transport molecules, whatever type they may be. In active transport, some types require the use of protein or carrier transport molecules. What are the further types of passive transport? Osmosis and simple diffusion, which do not require any special protein or carrier transport molecules. Another process is endocytosis in active transport, which is the movement of large molecules into a cell, and a cell membrane folds around the molecules. This requires energy. So these are basically describing the types and the examples of both type of transports that we just discussed. So here's just a brief example. Like, you know, small gas molecules like oxygen, nitrogen, how do they enter the cell membrane? By the process of diffusion. We just studied diffusion. It is simple transport. No carrier proteins, okay, are required, or no energy. And then what is the process by which water diffuses from one place to another? It is osmosis. And the glucose, amino acids and salts, they enter the cell or leave the cell by active transport. So these are just some examples of the types of transport. Molecules in simple diffusion, they move through the membrane without binding with carrier proteins. Now, if they don't bind to carrier proteins, how do they travel? Now, there could be three mechanisms. Either they just pass through the lipid bilayer casually. It's no big deal. Like interstices of the lipid bilayer, like we studied, they just pass through it. And then there are watery channels in transport proteins. These channels could provide the pathway through which they enter. And the energy source is the normal kinetic energy that is possessed by all molecules, all subatomic particles. Now there's another very special mechanism that occurs in simple diffusion. It is known as gating. Now what do you mean by gating? These are like gate-like extensions of transport proteins, and they control permeability. Now the gating could be of two types, voltage-gated channels or ligand-gated ion channels. Now in simple diffusion, we just talk about the entering and closing of channels. So what is the response? The response created by these channels could be due to what mechanism? According to the thing that makes them respond, it is named as voltage-gated channels because it responds to voltage, the potential difference across the cell membranes. Like in action potentials or in nerve cells, what happens is usually the cell membrane is negative inside and more positive outside. When this is altered, the inside of the cell membrane gets less negative, the cell depolarizes. And in response to this depolarization, these gates open, the sodium gates open, and more sodium influx happens inside, which will trigger an action potential. And this is a very short-lived phenomena of mere few milliseconds. And when this happens, the gates open. In response to this voltage created the electromagnetic difference. The gates open, sodium influx occurs, and electromagnetic potential rises more. So, but when this finishes, the gates close and sodium ions are transported outwards again to maintain that relative negativity inside and positivity outside. This is a very short-lived phenomenon. It happens in nerve cells, known as action potential. So this is the example of voltage-gated channels. There could be potassium channels as well, chloride channels, calcium channels. They're all different types, examples of these voltage-gated channels, which open or close in response to changes in membrane potential in nerve, muscle, and cardiac cells. Now, similarly, there are other gates that open in response to regulatory molecules that bind with the channel protein, such as neurotransmitter receptors. Now, acetylcholine is a neurotransmitter, and there are acetylcholine-mediated gates that open when this molecule attaches to them. So this is another example of gates. So these gates are present and they help in opening the channels that then allow the different influx of different ions in the body. Now, as we discussed before as well, that was all about simple diffusion. Now we're talking about facilitated diffusion. As you can tell from the name, there are going to be some facilitators present in this process that are going to facilitate the whole process. Those are known as carrier proteins. It involves a carrier protein that has a specific binding site for the transported substance. An example is the movement of glucose from the extracellular fluid into the cells, which is known as glucose uptake. Now, we can study this in detail. In this slide, you can see that this is a phospholipid bilayer, and here is going to be a glucose transporter. That is the name given to the carrier protein. Now, glucose is going to be attached here, and the whole protein is going to change its conformation. It is going to change its structure and allow this glucose to come inside. This is a very simple example of facilitator diffusion. So the transport protein, which is known as a glucose transporter, it has a specific binding site for glucose. The binding changes its conformation and exposes the binding site to either the ECF or the cytosol. It would either allow it to come inside or either allow it to go outside. Now, what is meant by channel saturation? In simple diffusion, the rate of diffusion increases with concentration of substance. Now, this is a very obvious statement, as you can tell from if the substance has to travel from a high concentration area to a low concentration area, it will be directly proportional to the concentration of substance. The more the molecules of the substance, the more would be the rate of simple diffusion. As you increase the substance, the more the traveling, the more the diffusion will increase. But in facilitated diffusion, carrier proteins come into the picture. Now, if the carrier protein cannot go through that conformational change, then it won't let the rate to be increased. So, the rate is dictated by the rate at which carrier protein can undergo conformational change. It does increase to a certain level by increasing the substance concentration, but then it stops after there's a limit, because there's only a limit a carrier protein can undergo the conformational change. So it will have to be dependent on the carrier protein. So if that occurs, there is no more facilitated diffusion, then it is known as channel saturation. Now, what are the factors that affect diffusion? As we already discussed, the lipid solubility is the first factor is lipid solubility. What does it mean? It means that the molecules which are more lipid soluble and less water soluble, they can easily pass through the membrane. Just like oxygen, nitrogen, and carbon dioxide, they are more lipid soluble. So the lipid bilayer allows them easily to pass through the membrane. The permeability. Permeability is the allowance of the substances to go inside of a membrane. Now, what is permeability dependent on? It is dependent on the size of the molecule, the diameter, the shape, whether it's negative or positive, it's polar or not. So these things matter when you're talking about permeability. And the concentration difference, obviously in simple diffusion, as the more the concentration difference, the more will be the rate of the diffusion. The more the molecules of the solute traveling, the more would be the difference, and then the more would be the diffusion. And electrical potential. Now, as we just discussed the action potential, the voltage-gated ion channels, we discussed about the electrical potential that caused the influx of sodium ions inside of the membrane. And so the electrical potential was a stimulus that opened the voltage-gated ion channels. So it is also a factor that affects diffusion, and temperature as well. Okay, now osmosis is also a type of simple diffusion. But why is it called osmosis? Because it is basically, this term is exclusively for water molecules. How the movement of water occurs from an area of high concentration to an area of low concentration. So that is osmosis. So there are two, what is the main significance of this process? The examples of this process would include, like, the roots, they take up water from the soil through the process of osmosis. The roots act as semi-permeable membrane, and the water diffuses through that membrane, goes into the roots, and then replenishes the whole plant. The example could be like a glass of water replenishes our whole body and hydrates our whole body through the process of osmosis. So these are the most simplest of examples of osmosis, which occur in our daily life. Now, in this diagram, there are three types of environments shown. These terms are very important in terms of osmosis. So in this first diagram, you can see that the environment is hypertonic. Hypertonic would mean that there is more solute in the environment surrounding the cell than solvent or water. So if there's this solution or the environment outside the cell is very hypertonic, more solute and more concentrated, then the water will flow from inside to outside to create a balance between the two environments. So if the water goes outside of the cell will shrink. So if somebody asks you what happens to the cell in a hypertonic environment, you could say that the cell shrinks or it shrivels up because the water goes outside to balance the environment. Now in this diagram, you can see it is written isotonic. Isotonic means when the rate of flow of water from outside to inside is the same as the water coming from inside to outside. If the environments both have same amount of water and solutes, then there will be no net movement and the cell will remain flaccid and the environment would be known as isotonic. Now in the third diagram, you can see the water is going from outside to inside. When will this happen? This will happen when the outside environment is more hypotonic, which means there is more solvent outside and more solute inside. So the water will try to balance out this difference. This is the first most, the foremost responsibility, you could say, of water to balance out the differences of this concentration difference. So the water will try to go inside and the environment would be known as hypotonic. What will happen to the cell? It will become turgid. It will swell up when the water goes inside. So the two conditions for osmosis to occur. Number one, we would need a semi-permeable membrane through which the molecules will diffuse from an environment or one place to the other. And secondly, we would require a difference in concentration. In this diagram, you can see the net flow of water is from this, from the right side to the left, because this solution is dilute salt or sugar solution. Dilute means its concentration of water molecules is more than the solute molecules. So water will try to go to that other side to balance out this difference. So there's another example which is very interesting. What is going to happen to the red blood cells if they are placed in a very concentrated sugar solution? If the solution is very concentrated, what is going to happen to these cells? The water is going to, the solution is very concentrated, so the water will come out of these cells to go into the environment and try to normalize this difference. The cells will shrink. They will lose their water because their water will go out. So the RBCs will shrink. Okay, now let's move on to the other major type of transport that occurs across the cell membranes. First, we discussed the passive transport, which involved diffusion, the different types of diffusion, simple diffusion and facilitated, and osmosis. Now we come to the active transport. It is different from passive transport in many ways, as we discussed earlier. The key features would include, it will be against a concentration gradient, which means it will the molecules travel from a low concentration area to a high concentration area. The energy expenditure via ATP hydrolysis, which is the cellular energy, and it might happen in combination with a carrier protein as well. So these are the basic three points that cover the active transport. In this animation, you can see the sodium ions, which are the yellow molecules you can see in this diagram. They are going out and the potassium ions are coming in. For every three sodium ions that are going out, two potassium ions are coming inside. But this whole process is being carried out with the help of energy, which is ATP. And this is just for your review, this is a phospholipid bilayer. This is a carrier protein which has receptors for these ions, and they are traveling the sodium ions outside and potassium ions inside by the process of ATP hydrolysis. This is a typical example of sodium potassium pump. We are going to discuss that in the next section. Now the active transport is further divided into two types, subtypes you could say. The primary active transport and the secondary active transport. The energy derived directly from the breakdown of ATP. In primary active transport, the energy will directly come from ATP. There is absolutely no confusion in that. In the secondary active transport, the energy is derived secondarily from energy that has been stored in the form of ionic concentration differences between the two sides of a membrane. This energy might be ATP, but not coming directly at that moment from ATP. This process occurs simultaneously from the energy that is already being stored in the form of concentration gradients or differences across the two membranes. Now, sodium potassium electrogenic pump. This is a pump that is present in all cells of the body. It is present in all cells of the body, and the main function would be maintaining the cell volume and creating an overall negativity inside of the cell. We already know that the cell membrane's inside part is more negative than positive, and the outside part is more positive than negative. Now, how this happens? This happens because of the sodium-potassium electrogenic pump. This pump transports 3 sodium ions outside of the cell and 2 potassium ions inside of the cell. So as you can see, comparatively, there are more positive ions outside. So there is positivity outside at all times usually and negativity inside. Now this can reverse when we talk about action potentials and voltage gated ion channels like we discussed earlier. Transiently, this polarity reverses in some procedures, this reverses and action potentials are generated. But usually this is a normal membrane potential. Now this electrogenic pump is shown in this diagram that we just watched. Now you will understand it better. The 3 sodium ions going out and 2 potassium ions going inside, and they maintain the overall negativity of the cell membrane and positivity outside. And this happens, this cannot happen without ATP. Now why is that so? Because you can see that sodium is being transported outside against the concentration gradient. There is more sodium outside. There is more sodium outside than inside. But still, this sodium has to go outside against the concentration gradient. So this will require energy. It will require a push. And that is provided by the ATP. And same as potassium ions, which are going inside from a low concentration area to a high concentration area. So it's not as easy as simple diffusion. So we just discussed the sodium potassium electrogenic pump as well, how it transports ions, how it maintains the cell volume. Okay, so we also discussed it maintains cell volume. How is that so? Whenever sodium ions go outside, they also take some water with them as well. So this basically, this balances out the water coming in by pushing out the water with sodium ions. So it basically maintains the cell volume and keeps the cell turgid. It keeps the cell flaccid, or you could say it keeps the cell in its normal shape. Now this is the diagram showing glucose sodium cotransport. The cotransport is a type of secondary active transport, which means the energy coming is not directly from ATP. In this diagram, you can see this again. I am revising it again. Every time I tell you this, because I want you to know and I want you to memorize the lipid structure, lipid bilayer structure of the membrane. These are the hydrophilic heads, hydrophobic ends. And here you can see this is a sodium binding site here. It will bind sodium ion here. And simultaneously, glucose will also be bound to this glucose binding site. So as the sodium ion comes inside, the glucose also comes inside. So this, from the name itself, you can tell is the example of a cotransport. This as well, the secondary active transport examples are shown in this diagram. When, like in this diagram, you saw that sodium ion was coming in, it brought glucose inside as well. So this is cotransport. But when one molecule is coming inside in one direction and the other molecule is going outside, so these are two opposite directions we're talking about. One is coming inside the cell and one is going outside the cell, or in the opposite direction. That would be known as countertransport. Countertransport and cotransport, these both are types of secondary active transport. In this diagram, you can see the direction of the arrows show that both the molecules are going in one direction only. Sim port would be the name given to the protein that carries out this transport. And in antiport or counter transport, you could see that the directions of the arrows are in opposite direction. These both are not going the same way. One is going out, one is going in. Now the bulk transport. What is bulk transport? There's not only by these processes like we discussed, like diffusion, we discussed active transport. There is another mechanism by which the cell takes in materials and expels out molecules. So that would be known as bulk transport. Now, the bulk transport would be broadly classified into two major processes, the endocytosis and the exocytosis. First, let us talk some more about endocytosis. The endocytosis is basically the procedure by which the particles are taken in, and it is usually food or those nutrients that are required by the cell to function properly. The endocytosis is they are further divided into two subtypes, pinocytosis and phagocytosis. Now, what is the difference between phagocytosis and pinocytosis? Phagocytosis is the name given to the cell eating. You could say in layman terms, it is cell eating, when cell eats something. And pinocytosis is the process in which the cell drinks something. So usually it is either water or some very minute particles along with ECF, extracellular fluid. That would involve pinocytosis. The major procedure involved in pinocytosis would be invagination, which means the infolding of the cell membrane. How, when there's a, when this water, this water molecule that needs to be acquired by the cell, it will form an invagination of the cell membrane around it, form vesicles, and then take it in. And in phagocytosis, the food particles are engulfed by pseudopodia. Now, you might already know what pseudopodia are. These are feet-like extensions of cytoplasm, which engulf the substance to be eaten and then form a structure around it. Like in this diagram, you can see the food particle taken in by endocytosis. This is pseudopodia, which is a feet-like extension of the cytoplasm. It will go around this food particle and then form a vacuole, or you could say it will form a vesicle. And then when this is digested by the cell, it will form waste products, the products of digestion. And these toxic waste substances need to be expelled from the cell. Just like we need to expel the toxic substances and waste substances from our body, the cell also needs to do that. It cannot keep the nutrients and the waste material simultaneously inside it. So what is the process that expels out the waste? That is known as exocytosis. So endocytosis means taking in of food or water, and exocytosis is taking out of the waste materials. As you can see, these are the products of digestion and they need to be expelled out of the cell. Now, how is the cell going to do that? The cell is going to do that by making a vesicle around it and then going towards the cell membrane. It will fuse with the cell membrane and then the contents will be expelled out of the cell membrane. So this is basically the outline of the bulk transport. There is also another type of transport in bulk transport, that is receptor mediated engulfment. That would just be dependent on various receptors that trigger the taking in or engulfment of the food particle, and then the same process occurs just like this. So now we are going to briefly explain what we studied today. In our daily life, we studied the simple diffusion that is happening, occurring around us all the time. Just like in your high school science books, you studied when there is a beaker of glass placed in front of you and the ink with a dropper is, an ink drop is placed inside that glass, and then that color of the ink will turn the whole beaker of that same color. Like if it's blue, the whole beaker will convert, will be converted to blue, and this will happen in within seconds. So that is the example of simple diffusion. And diffusion occurs in plants, how they take up water. It happens in our digestive system. It happens in our intestines, how they take up water, how they lose water. So that is why it is very important to know how these mechanisms work. We studied about cell, and then we studied about cell membrane and its functions. So let us revise the function. Let us revise the structure of the cell membrane again. It is a phospholipid bilayer, which means it's a bilayer. It is made up of two layers, and in between is the hydrophobic part, and the heads would be the hydrophilic parts. And the phosphate part is present in the head and it is polar. That is why it allows water very easily to go through it. So that is all about our lecture today, where we studied about cell membranes, cell membrane, its functions, and the types of membrane transport. Thank you very much. This is all for today, and keep visiting sqadia.com for further lectures. Thank you.